Hi, my name is Johnny Martinez, and I'm the leader of the Hollywood Salsa Machine here in Los Angeles, California. I've been working here for close to 35 years now, and very proud of the fact that I've been working here for 35 years every week. Never had under 4 or 5 days a week, and right now I'm on a roll, I guess. From the last several years, I've been working 5 and 6 days, and I've always worked 5 or 6 days, but I'm one of the lucky ones. Anyway, I'm going to just talk about my life as a child and how I grew up into this business. I remember way back in 1930s when I was a little boy. I must have been 6 or 7 years old, and I used to sit in the living room and watch my father rehearse his orchestras. My father was the first man in Chicago to ever have and organize a Latin band made up of nothing but Latinos. He was very proud of that. However, my father was a genius. There's so many things I could tell you about my father that you just probably wouldn't believe. He wasn't an educated man, but he was a genius. Everything he did was wonderful. I couldn't believe the things he did. And now that I'm older and I think about it, I say, wow, he was a genius. Anyway, he was rehearsing this band, and I'd sit there and listen and listen. It was a band, but maybe 15 members in the band, 15, and they were all young, they were all trying to play music. Some of them read very well and some just fair. But they used to buy the orchestrations from the store. You know, they used to sell arrangements in the music stores of all the bands that were popular at the time. And every band in Chicago would buy these arrangements from the store and try to play them. Well, my father was no different. He went and bought these arrangements, played them, tried to play them. Anyway, they sounded okay. He'd play some dances and weddings and things with this 15-piece band. And, oh, he thought he was hot stuff. He got tired of having these men give him problems by not showing up. But, well, you know, musicians, we're artists and we like to float around. We go all over. So he decided, well, maybe I will make an all-girl band. So he organized a 13-piece all-girl band, and they played the arrangements, and they were pretty good. It surprised me. They were better than the men because they were more dedicated to the music. And being a young kid, I could recognize and tell that they weren't playing too bad. So this went on for several years, and my dad always used to see me sitting there watching. I remember between bands, he was rehearsing a mariachi group. Now, mariachi was his love. He really loved mariachi music. And I'd be sitting there watching this mariachi group, and all the boys in the mariachi group were saying, "Hey, Mr. Arnulfo," that was his name, Arnulfo Martinez, says, "Your son must like music. He sits here through the whole rehearsal, just sitting there real quiet looking at us." So in between tunes, my father came over to me and said, "Johnny," or he used to call me Chano, "this Chano, you like the music?" I said, "Yes, I love it, Daddy." He says, "What instrument do you like best of all?" So I told him, "I like the one with the, you know, the one that they scratch with the bow." He says, "Oh, the violin." And I says, "Yeah, I like that." So he says, "Well, let's call Tommy over." Tommy was the fellow that was playing the violin. And you know, he lived next door to the house. And he said, "Tommy, come over here." So he came over. "I want you to meet my son, Chano, here." He says, "He loves the way you play the violin." He says, "Oh, do you? You like violin, huh?" I says, "Yeah, I like violin." He says, "Well, here, hold it." So he put it in my hands, and I was so afraid I might drop it or break it or splinter it or something. I mean, it was a delicate thing to me to have a violin in my hands, but I loved it, and they gave me the bow, and I tried to strum it with the violin on my lap, you know. I couldn't get a sound, but scratches and all that. But I thought that was really wonderful. Anyway, my father, I guess, decided to buy me a violin because he went to Maxwell Street in Chicago the following weekend. And Maxwell Street is a street, it's like these meets they have here in Los Angeles, what do they call them? Anyway, you know, where everybody takes junk and they spread it out on the sidewalks at flea markets. Anyway, they spread it out all over the street there every weekend on Maxwell Street. And you can buy anything from rings, clothing, old skates, bicycles, musical instruments, tools, anything. Anyway, you could buy a pair of skates for 3 cents or a bicycle for $1 or, you know, whatever. Anyway, he came home with his violin. And he says, "Chano, look what I got for you." So he opened up the case and there was a beautiful violin. I said, "Oh my God." I didn't know how much he paid for it. He probably paid $5 for it, or, knowing my father, $3. But it was a nice violin. It looked real nice, and I picked it up and I just had it in my lap and clunked it with my fingers. Just loved the sounds of it. I didn't know what to do with it, but I used to just enjoy having it in my hand. Well, one day my father says, "Johnny, come on, bring your violin. I'm taking you over to the settlement house here." It was a place where they used to have, you know, arts and crafts and musical classes and gymnasiums and swimming. And it was like the YMCA, but it wasn't quite. It was for the poor people and the immigrants from Mexico who used to come there. Anyway, he took me to this violin class where they had about 10 violin pupils and a teacher named Professor Barbare, who was Italian, I guess Italian-French. And he had these kids learning how to play violin. Well, my dad brought me in. I guess he had it arranged to with the professor to bring me in, because he says, "Mr. Paparay, this is my son Chano, and I would like him to learn with you." I says, "Oh, sure." So Professor Paparay gave me some lessons on the side, private lessons, to the point where I could read. And of course, my father used to teach me how to solfeo when I was a little kid. He taught the whole family solfeggio. And we were pretty good at it, so I had no problem reading music. I wasn't fantastic, but at least I knew where do, re, mi, fa, sol, la, si, do was, you know. So I took the violin, and the professor would teach me where do was, where re, and went along. Well, a few weeks went by, and I started to play scales fairly good. You know, not great, but they were fairly good. And he finally put a tune in front of me, and I would try to play it, and he would play it with me. And then he had me join the group, the orchestra, which was nothing but violins, but it was nice being there trying to play with these other kids. I learned to play violin, and we had several recitals where I'd be playing a song for all the parents, of course. And that was interesting, because my father was always there coaxing me, coaching me, and telling me what to do and how to act. And my father was very funny that way. He took interest in us boys. You know, he had 4 boys and 2 girls, and I was the only one that was really into music. So he loved music, so he kind of treated me nice, special. My father would sit there, and he'd dress me up in these little black pants and a white shirt and a bow tie, and I'd go out there and play Estrellita or La Golondrina, you know, real pretty songs, and I'd get a big round of applause. Oh, I'd feel so good about that. Anyway, years went by, and I started getting pretty good with the violin. I was actually playing very hard stuff. I was getting real good at it. When I got of age where I used to watch all the kids outside playing baseball and football, basketball. And I said, "Gee, I'd like to try that."